Good afternoon again, everyone. I trust that you are enjoying your lunch if you haven't got your way through it. Just a little treat to get you through your main course before we chat to a couple of gentlemen. In fact, we're going to have a big treat coming on too, because the two heads of South Australia's AFL teams, Rob Chapman and David Koch, are going to join me in a moment. Before we do that, chance to top up the glasses, sit back, relax. Now, over the years, if you've had the chance, maybe for some of us who are in our younger years, you're out of the pub, Chunky Custard have come up on the stage. You'll know our next guest, Becky Blake, of course. She's also known as the Piano Chick and has performed at the Adelaide Fringe to rave reviews. Can you please put your hands together? She's, of course, donating her time to a cause that is very close to her heart as well. Please give Becky Blake a big welcome.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. How are we this afternoon at Adelaide Oval? I thought we'd kick off the set this afternoon with something just a little bit naughty. Here we go. Well, some girls, they like candy, and others, they like to grind. But I'll settle for the back of your hand, somewhere on my behind. Treat me like I'm a bad girl, even when I'm being good to you. I don't want you to thank me, you can just spank me. Let me get a better look at you now. Here's a party table. Some girls, they like sweet talk, and others, they like to tease. But tie my hands behind my back, and ooh, I'm in ecstasy. Don't smother me with kisses. No, I can get that from my sisters. Let me speak to you frankly. Oh, you better like Hanky Panky. There's nothing like a good spank. Don't take out your handkerchiefs. I don't want to cry. I just want to thank you, thank you like Hanky Panky. There's nothing like a good spank. Don't take out your handkerchiefs. I don't want to cry. I just want to thank you, guy. Ooh, yeah. But please don't call a doctor, cause there's nothing wrong with me. I just like things a little rough, and you better not disagree. I don't like a big softy, no. I like someone mean and bossy. Let me speak to you frankly. You better like Angry Frankie. There's nothing like a good spanking. Don't take out your handkerchiefs. I don't wanna cry. I just wanna thank you, thank you, like thank you, thank you. There's nothing like a good spanking. Don't take out your handkerchiefs. I don't wanna cry. I just wanna thank you, guy. Ooh, yeah. Table 15. Oh, I like it like that. A little harder, please. Oh, that hurts just thinking about it. Treat me like I'm a bad girl, even when I'm being good to you. I don't want you to thank me. You can just like me. There's nothing like a good spank. Don't take out your handkerchiefs. I don't want to cry. I just want to thank you, thank you like thank you, thank you. There's nothing like a good spank. I don't wanna cry. I just wanna thank you, guy. I just winked at the camera. That's so Eurovision. Woo! Oh, that square came into this room. Doctor said later she's a beautiful girl. Well, I gave her a spanking and I got her to smile. So give it up, honey, cause I want it. Oh, yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you for that very warm welcome on my behind. Now, I thought this is not like the old Friday lunches. I remember them being in Rundle Street with a bottle of Chardonnay and the sun on the back of my head. But have a look at this. It's a fantastic turnout.
all about men's health and sport today. So what I thought I'd do is do a few sporting anthems for you. This one you know, of course. But it's all about applying the sporting anthems to fighting cancer, to kicking it in the butt, and letting it know who's boss. And of course, it's all about survival. So don't be afraid to get out that air guitar and have a little bit of a rock with me, okay? You ready? Here we go. This next song was known for American baseball. It was all about taking the game and smashing it out of the park and giving it your best shot. You're a real tough cookie with a long history, breaking little hearts like you wanted me. That's okay, let's see how you do it. Put up your dukes. Let's get down and do it. Hit me with your best shot. Why don't you hit me with your best shot? Hit me with your best shot. Fire away. So come on, honey, come on. You don't fight fair. That's okay. See if I care. Knock me down. It's all in vain. I'll get my back. On my feet again. Hit me with your best shot. Why don't you hit me with your best shot? Well, hit me with your best shot. Fire away. And we can't do sporting anthems without doing a little bit of Tina Turner. And the song, all about rugby league, I believe. Call me when I need you and my heart's on fire. Where's Jimmy? Oh, damn it. Here you come to me wild and wild. Ooh, when you come to me, give me everything I need. Give me a lifetime of promises, a world of dreams. Speak the language of love like you know what it means. Ooh, and it can't be wrong. Take my heart and make it stronger. Sing it along with me, come on. You're simply the best. Oh,
much, guys. Thank you for letting me have you this afternoon. Before I go, I'd like to do one more song, and I'd like to bring out the dancing girls again, my little cheerleaders from the Martine Quigley Dance Education. Thank you, and have a wonderful rest of your long lunch. Come on, girls. Why is it out too late? Got nothing in my brain. Oh, that's what people say, yeah. That's what people say, yeah. I go one too many days. But I can't make them stay. At least that's what people say, yeah. That's what people say, yeah. But I keep cruising. Can't stop, won't stop grooving. It's like I got this music in my mind saying it's gonna be alright. Because the player's gonna play, 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 play. And my haters gonna hate, 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 hate. I'm just gonna shake, 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 shake. Shake it off. Shake it off, and heartbreak is gonna break, 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 break. And the fake is gonna fake, 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 fake. I'm just gonna shake, 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 shake. Shake it off, shake it off. I'll never miss a beat. I'm landing on my feet. But that's what they don't see. Enjoy your long lunch.
Thank you to Becky Blake. Please, another round of applause. Got everyone pumped up and firing. And keep that applause going too, because we are now welcoming the head honchos, the big cheeses of South Australia's two AFL teams, Mr. Rob Chapman from the Crows and Mr. David Koch from the Port Adelaide Footy Club. Please give a big round of applause.
Tony Davidson from Channel 7 just spanked me as I was going by. He's obviously had a few too many drinks.
David
Koch, I'm Becky.
Welcome along.
How are you? How are things?
Robbie Thanks, Chapman, Davis. Boys, come forward. Come forward. I'm going to grab my mic here. Hang on.
How good was
Thank you, Deb.
How good was Becky, Koshy? Yep.
I know. Well, the the Port Club's a bit below budget at the moment. We're thinking of getting Becky and the dancers along to sort of boost the bottom line.
I've just been given Becky's microphone, and have a look at the state of my microphone.
Oh, gee.
Yeah, a little bit of lipstick. Goes with
your normal makeup.
Got a reasonable pink head on the bed. Now, Koshy.
What did you say?
Sorry? I didn't say that.
I'll tell you what Koshy said to me on the way up here, though. He said, Becky's got two things that we haven't got, Chappie. Nice hair. Like, more hair than what we've got, and a lovely voice. So,
and a good set of pins, too.
Yeah.
Very good. Now, gentlemen, of course, everyone in the room knows it has been an enormously tough year for both of your clubs, and I haven't seen you two standing this close since the dying moments of the showdown over on that wing there, and this was an astounding situation. I'm not sure if you wouldn't have seen it if you were there. Who went to the showdown, just the recent one, just so I get an idea in the room? Who watched it on TV? On Channel 7. Well done. Okay. So what happened was, look over at the wing here, and this is the dying minute, super tight game, a wonderfully fitting match for the situation that we're in. And I look over, and there's you two blokes. Can you just show me the pose that you two were in? I want you to reenact it, because you missed this. This was astounding. Boys, please, show me the pose.
Put your arm around me. That's it.
No.
Now, I reckon...
That was before the cameras were on.
Exactly. Yeah. The hand was a little lower before the cameras were on. Yeah. You guys stood there seriously for probably 5 or 6 minutes watching an enthralling contest, an amazing tribute to Philip Walsh, and it was quite moving, I think, to see you both in that position. I think there was...
But that's what footy is.
Yeah, it's amazing, though.
Footy, everyone gets in the rough and tumble and the... You know, the rivalry between the two clubs, but good things come out of footy clubs and the goodwill. You know, I remember the first time we had a meeting was you said, let's go to this quiet little cafe near where you lived. And I'd just been appointed and he said, because no one will be there. Well, 60,000 frickin' bike riders were there with, you know, all their Lycra having their cappuccino, because it wasn't the done thing for the two presidents to actually meet with the, and I found it pretty strange at that time. But we've worked together on the Adelaide Oval deal that I think was a great outcome for the Oval, for the tenants and also the taxpayer. And we both have the interests of South Australian footy at heart. We work on a lot of things together. And I like the bloke. I like his wife better.
Koshy's not bad for a big bloke either. But you do have to work collaboratively together, and you do have to see the bigger picture, and I think we both do. And our clubs that week, it was a very emotional week, and, you know, the tragedy that unfolded affected both of our clubs, and we, where Phil was, recognised that. And, you know, we didn't own that grief, and it was important, Koshy, for you and your club to partake, and... We did that week, you know, you're the first on the phone, and Keith, I think I spoke to every single day leading into that. And Chappie, just tell us what we need to do to make this day as easy as it could possibly be. And West Coast, the preceding week, did exactly the same. It's a wonderful, wonderful industry, football. And, you know, I said to Gillen that night, I said, mate, if anyone's having a crack at our industry, let me have 2 minutes with them and I can convince them otherwise. Yep. But,
and our supporter bases too.
Yep, agree.
You know, the goodwill, all rivalry aside, when the other side's down or the other club's down on its luck or needs a big hug, the other club's supporters will do it. I know when we started the rebuild of Port Adelaide, the number of Crows supporters... that would come up to me in the street, or they all seem to work at security at the airport and would pat you down and stuff like that, and say, mate, don't barrack for you, but geez, wish you well because we want two strong South Australian teams. And I think the goal of both of us is that this time next year, we can be the same as Freo and West Coast, and we'll be Freo, you could be West Coast, 1 and 2 on the ladder would be terrific. That's the aim, isn't it?
Yep. Are they still patting you down at the airport?
Yeah.
I thought I'd lifted that instruction.
No, they've got, they've gone from a pat down to a squirrel grip.
Well, Paul Patterson, of course, who was one of the inaugural Crows, looks up. You're, of course, the man that looks after the airport, but he looked after all the security there. So there was someone on the inside, Koshy.
Making sure they're going there.
Are we going there? That big bloke from Sunrise about to come through. Make sure you get a hold of him. This goodwill that exists between you guys, does that extend to tomorrow? Because you're hosting the Giants here.
Yep.
The Giants are very, very close, just a half a game behind you guys, and you're, what, I think less than 1% outside the eight.
Yeah, no, we'll, so we'll kick their ass tomorrow for you.
Tomorrow there's going to be some support again.
Yep. Yeah.
Well, there's the headline. Port Adelaide are going to kick GWS's ass. They're just out there training, Koshy. But look, this is the stage of the year when you actually start barracking for a lot of sides, don't you? You're barracking for the four or five that you're competing with, whose spot you want to take in the eight. So, it's a toss-up for me. I only used to barrack for Collingwood when they played Port Adelaide, but I'd rather see GWS lose tomorrow. So.
Of course, you guys still kicking very hard. Good chance. Controlling your own destiny at the moment too. We're not worrying about all the mathematics of it just quite yet. It has been a tough season. The response of the team since the tragedy has been quite remarkable, hasn't it?
Oh, look, it has, and a lot of credit due to the coaching group that we've got down at our football club, led by Scott Camporelli. He's done a terrific job, and he, given his relationship with Walshy, has really stood up. And I know that's a cliche, but someone needed to in our club, and just make sure they were galvanised, and he's been that person down there. John Worsfold coming in has been that steadying influence, that sage, wise head in the background. His leadership should not be underestimated. But look, really close group that have responded. We had a shocking game against Sydney, but when I listened to the Sydney chairman's pre-match address and what that whole Adam Good scenario had meant for his team and how the players were going to respond, I knew we were in for a really tough night. But last week here at Adelaide Oval, 50,000 people, it was probably the best game for us for the year. Four quarters of team performance, team effort, and to beat Richmond, having just beaten the reigning premiers the week before, was a good effort. So to get them up, you know, there's something there that's just a little bit special, and we need to back it up again. It'll mean nothing if we don't back that up again at Etihad tomorrow.
Koshy, we just heard Rob mention Adam Goods.
Yeah,
pretty contentious issue. I think everyone in the room knows exactly what was going on there. Perhaps they might not be aware of why some people were booing. You came out pretty strong on it. I heard you speak pretty forthright about it. What was going on in your mind when you hear that?
Look, and I think it's a whole generational thing as well. And this whole myth, as I said before our game last weekend before last, this whole myth about Goods. Yes, everyone has the right to boo. There's no doubt about that. The umpires get booed all the time. Our teams get booed for poor performances. But the length and the intensity of it was overstepping the bounds. And this whole industry, oh, no, we're not booing him for any other reason because we don't like the bloke. We don't like the bloke because he plays for free kicks and gets too many. Well, the facts are champion data. Shows that he's currently 180th in the league in terms of players, in terms of getting penalties. Free kicks in the last 4 years, he's been in the 160s. Oh, we don't like him because he talked about Australia Day being Invasion Day. Read his speech on Australia Day. It says no such thing at all. He says some parts of his community refer to Invasion Day. He doesn't. He sees it as a celebration of both white and black Australians and what we've achieved. And, oh, we don't like him because he called out a 13-year-old girl who called him an ape. You know, he was, and whose mother is disabled. Well, you know, he heard a voice in the crowd. It was a spur of the moment thing. And you read the words that he supported that girl after were just extraordinary. So there's this myth about Adam Goods. I get very emotional about it because my family's a mixed race family. And it staggers me, the casual racism that is out there. Oh, you black bastard, just joking. Well, when you get it two, three times a week, you think these young blokes put up with so much that they shouldn't have to. And usually it's from middle-aged, privileged, white blokes who do it. And we just got to change because our kids want us to change. It's just not good enough.
Did both of you or either of you find the need to talk to your players and your club about the situation at all?
Like our Aboriginal programs, and my wife isn't a big AFL fan, she loves our club because of the Aboriginal programs, our remote, which we are incredibly proud of. He's terrifically generous, the Prime Minister, Tony Abbott, actually gives us money out of his personal budget every year for our APY lands. And people say, gee, you do great thing for the Aboriginal community. I say to them, we get great stuff back as a club for doing those programs. It's a two-way street.
Rob, what about you? How did you deal with this with the Crows?
No need to step in. The players of all clubs are very well educated. They're in a very good system where they're across all social issues. And as it applies to Adam, you know, if there's somebody that is feeling unsafe or unwelcome or just not at the top of their game, well, you know, we do need to do something about that. Everybody deserves the right to be respected, and regardless whether it's race, religion, sexual preference, it doesn't matter. You all have the right to respect.
And he's speaking on behalf of our players who are too scared because the general stance in the Australian Cup, we love you as an Aboriginal sports person, but hey, don't you have an opinion? Don't you sort of go overboard in supporting a culture? You just play and shut up. But Adam speaks for all our Aboriginal players, and I should imagine yours as well.
Oh, look, very much so. You know, I try not to even differentiate. I don't even like talking about Aboriginal versus other players. And I know you're the same. I mean, we just should treat them the same, you know. Same with gender. You know, I don't even like talking about females versus males in the workplace. We should be way beyond that now. And I think football actually is leading that agenda and that debate way more than perhaps what business is itself.
Okay, before we hand over to you, Koshy, because you're going to run this panel in a moment, one thing I want to ask. Brocky said before everyone needs to get off their backsides, you lead your clubs.
Yep.
Are you leading your families and your friends? Have you been tested, Rob Chapman?
Yeah, every year the late Brian Sando was my regular. Yep. He reckons he could tell everybody's prostate by its touch. It had its own signature, its own DNA, if you like. That's what he used to tell me. But yes, I do. And like many in the room, I'm sure we've all got our stories of people that wouldn't be here had they not been tested, had they not discovered it early enough. And the fact that they did meant they were able to get some preventative medicine.
And going to the doctor once a year and hearing the slap of the plastic glove.
Do you like
and
it,
the,
Koshy?
And the bend over and just relax. You should embrace that. You should embrace it every year. It's not that frightening. It's not that frightening.
On that note, I'll sit down and let Koshy just relax up here and...
Look at I can see the cogs sticking over your head. It's like when you're doing the memories there.
No, I'm watching Keith, who's saying, stop there, stop there.
Koshy, I'm going to hand over to you right now because you're going to get some people up here, some very famous South Australians. Rob Chapman, please put your hands together.
Welcome,
Rob. Rob, you're about to hop on a plane. You're disappearing around the world, aren't you, right now? David Koshy, I'm going to hand over to you.
Thank you,
Soders. Good luck to the Power tomorrow. Good luck to the Crows tomorrow.
Thank you. Give Rob another round of applause as well and wish them well on the weekend. One of the really nice guys in AFL. All right, ladies and gentlemen, have we got a panel for you to talk sport, to talk prostate as well today. First up, would you welcome to the stage the master himself, Adelaide's own champion jockey with a career spanning 30 years, riding 2,350 winners. He's had 25 Group 1 wins, including 3 Adelaide Cups and 2 Melbourne Cups. We put the Adelaide Cup first because that's more important. Would you welcome Johnny Letts? An ex-panelist played and captained the Adelaide Lightning to 4 premierships in Australia's WNBL. She was twice the league's MVP, 8 times selected in the All-Star 5. She heads the all-time point scoring and rebound list, played 304 games for her country with the Australian women's basketball team, the Opals, including 3 Olympics. She's got 2 silver medals and a bronze and 3 world championships. Would you welcome Rachael Sporn?
Thank you.
A legend of the bike, a professional road cyclist, riding between 1995 and 2003. Maybe you two should sit down. He competed in the Tour de France since 1997. He's ridden in the 2004 Summer Olympics. In the Tour de France, he has worn the coveted green and yellow jerseys during his career, and more importantly, has won two Tour Down Under events. Stuart O'Grady. A 300 gamer for Norwood in the Sandfold from 79 to 93, winning the McGarry medal at just 20, won Norwood's best and fairest four times, played All Australian twice, 15 state games, went to Ireland, and was awarded the Australian Sports Medal, the highest individual honour in South Australian football, Michael Aish. And finally, if you could describe someone as a tough nut in South Australian footy, it would be this bloke. Took three clubs to four Sandfold premierships over three decades. He played and coached at West Adelaide, South Adelaide, Glenelg, coached at West Torrens and Central Districts, 32 state games for South Australia, another Channel 7 staffer. Would you welcome Knuckles Kerley? Guys, good to see you. Welcome.
Thank you.
How come you've got the shortest chair?
Well, I got... David, I actually got here with the biggest bird.
Keep well away from him, Rachael. I tell you what, keep well away from him. Johnny, let's start with you. Career highlights for you. Everyone would automatically say the Melbourne Cup. Is that the pinnacle for you?
Well, the second one was, David, because... the first one was a bit of a shock. The story's been well documented. I went to Melbourne, never seen Flemington, never met the horse. I never seen him. I only met him that day as I went to get on him, and I never seen him again.
Really? That was the one ride on that one horse, and you just, basically like a carnival ride, just got him once in the mounting yard.
I went to Melbourne on the Sunday to have a look at Flemington on Monday because I'd never been there.
Yeah.
And I slept in. So I thought, well, I better go Tuesday morning. And I slept in again. And so then I had to get to Flemington, and I thought, Flemington's pretty easy to get to on Melbourne Cup Day. This day there was 110,000 people there, which I'd never experienced. So I went downstairs to the motel and said to the young girl, would you get me a cab to Flemington, please? She said, you won't get a cab today. And I rang my brother, who was in Melbourne at the time, and I said, you better get me to Flemington today. I said, I've got to ride in the Melbourne Cup. He said, have you? And I said, yeah. My brothers had gone to work. They were playing golf. My parents had gone to work. So everybody was pretty interested in the ride. And so I got to Flemington, David, and I walked. I'll never forget, I was about this high, and I had a race. I'm not much taller now, really. I had a race bag in this hand with my race gear in, like the jockeys carry, and I had a saddle on this arm. Adelaide, I could walk through the gate without even showing my pass because I was always tipping to the gatekeepers and that, you know, and they'd just, good on you, Letchy, what do you got today? And I'd tell them what I thought. Over there, it's a little bit different, Melbourne Cup Day. There's these guys, once a year, they have a white coat on that work on the gate, and they have a sheriff's badge. They're all of a sudden, they're John Wayne. And I rang my brother, and he picked me up, and we drove into Flemington, like a horseshoe shape, and you get out the gate and you walk through the members. Well, in Adelaide, I could do it. So I get out the car, and he drives off, and I got a race bag in this hand and a saddle in this arm. And I went to walk through the gate. And the guy said, where are you going? I said, in here. He said, what for? Well, what would a guy this high, with a saddle on this arm, a bag of race gear in this arm, be doing at Flemington on Melbourne Cup Day? I said, I'm the plumber. And I thought I'd actually get away with that. But he said, well, the plumbers use that gate down there. So I went into the jockey's room, and they were all there. Harry White, Roy Higgins, Midge Didham, all of them, Pat Hyland, and me. There was 24 of us. And I went up to Harry White. I just said to Harry, I said, how do you ride Flemington, Harry? And he said, go to sleep till you get to Chiquita Lodge. He said, and then get into the race. I said, thanks. And I walked away, and I thought, Chiquita Lodge. Must be a 30-story high motel with a big sign that says Chiquita Lodge. I won't miss that. But it's actually a little racing stable at the 1,000 metres on the outside of the track. So when I went out to get on the horse, George Handlin had four runners, and he spoke to the other three jockeys. Never spoke to me. The owner didn't,
well, he didn't
know me.
Probably didn't know who you were.
He didn't.
He hadn't turned up for 4 days.
I'd never seen him before. And the owner didn't speak to me because he didn't know me. And when I went to get on the horse, the only part of that horse I seen was the side of him and his ears and his neck. That was the only part I ever seen of that horse ever. And number 16. And I thought, go to sleep, Chiquita Lodge, get into the race. I'll do what Harry said. So I went out to get on the horse, and there was a little girl strapper there. I had no instructions, and I think that helped me win the race because I had no pressure to do what the trainer wanted me to do. And I said to the young girl, I said, how do you ride this horse? Up the front, the back, in the middle of it? She said, I don't know. She said, but you better ride him properly. So everything was going to plan at that stage. So I got down to the barrier, and I'll never forget this. I drew barrier 11. Roy Higgins drew barrier 10, and Higgs had been around here, and I knew Roy from coming to Adelaide. And I thought, he's on Gun Sin. Do you remember him?
Yeah.
The Gundawindi Grey.
Yeah.
I thought, well, he's the only grey horse in the race. He's drawn 10, I've drawn 11. I can't miss him. I said, if the clerk of the course joins in, I'm in a bit of trouble. Because there'll be two greys then. So I'm sitting in the barrier, and it's a feeling that you can't describe, because there's 110,000 people out there and they're waiting for the gates to open, you know, to break the gate. And it goes, what you see on television is a lot of noise, a lot of stuff. But just before the start of a Melbourne Cup, it's dead quiet when the last two or three walk in. They go 1, 12, 2, 13, 3, and that's how they go. And while I was sitting there, Neville Voigt from Sydney was on Hayburner. And I looked across, and Neville had ridden in a few Melbourne Cups. And I said to Nev, what do you think?
He said, well, this is in the starting gates.
That's in the gates. I said, what do you think, Nev? He said, not much. I said, you got a chance? He said, no. I said, these are stable mates, yours and mine. He said, yeah. He said, but look, he said, I'll tell you something. Have a good ride. He said, it's a good race to ride in. He said, you might learn something out of this. So I thought, plan B will have to be, wherever Gun Sind is, the only grey, I'll follow him. And he's drawn alongside me, and Roy walked in. We're sitting in the gate, and of course you hear Greg Miles. The last words you'll hear is, they're all in the Melbourne Cup. And then, they're racing in the Melbourne Cup. And that's then the roar of the crowd, which is like a brick wall hitting the jockeys and the horses. It's like a brick wall. And I thought, Gun Sind, wherever you go, I will be one step behind you and Higgins. Gun Sind missed the jump. And I was in front of him. And I thought, well, wouldn't that bugger that up? I thought, if Higgins is going to follow me, he's in a bit of trouble, because I've never been around here before. So, you know, we go down the straight, go to sleep, like Harry said, get round the back, and I'm thinking, Chiquita Lodge, Chiquita Lodge. I've got to find Chiquita Lodge and make my run there, make my run at Chiquita Lodge. We go down the mile and a quarter, it's not there. Down at the 9, it's not there. Down at the 8, it's not there. 7, 6, I thought, they must have pulled this joint down last night. We get about the 1,000 metres, and all of a sudden, whoosh, right alongside me, the grey head, Gun Sind, and Higgins is off. And, you know, my plan was then, go when Roy goes. And, you know, 12 other jockeys had the same plan. And we turned for home, and I'm not kidding you, what you see in a Melbourne Cup is what you get. There's 24 horses, but there's 12 trying to get into a spot where there's 24 trying to get into a spot where there's only room for 12. So you're wearing a bloke's elbow, and you're wearing another bloke's whip, and you're getting another bloke's spurs in your shins. This is the Melbourne Cup, the parts that you don't see. So we straighten up for home, and I'm running about 12th, and I thought, I'm going to beat half these home. My first ride in the Melbourne Cup was my ambition to have a ride in the Melbourne Cup, but I don't care if I never get another one. I've beaten half of them home. Then I get down 11th, 10th, 9th, 8th, and we're getting down the straight, and I thought, I know the winning post is down there, but I didn't exactly know where it was. And I get down with 50 metres to go, and I've got one horse in front of me, the favourite, Magnifique. Bruce Marsh was on her. And another thought went through my mind, fall over, you bitch. Well, she slowed up because she must have read my thoughts. And I went on and won the Melbourne Cup. And as I went over the line, it's a surreal feeling. I went over the line and I thought, oh, I've won a race at Flemington. And a guy come up, hit me on the back. He said, good on you, son, you've won the Melbourne Cup. I thought, I've won the bloody Melbourne Cup. And I didn't even know where I was.
Well,
the incredible part about it, David, was, as I told you, my parents and my brothers and that, they weren't sort of, I was on an 80-to-1 chance. I went out on a track that day, and you know, you walk down the roses, and I never knew a soul. One bloke even spelt my name when they used to have Let's Rent a Car, L-E-T-Z. Didn't even spell it properly, one of the blokes, one of the course announcers. And I walked down there, never knew a soul. 3.5 minutes later, I came back. And I had all my mothers and my fathers and my cousins. They were all there. Everyone knew me. So within 3.5 minutes, I'd become, from, say, being an Australian jockey and won premierships here, you become, the minute you hit the line in the Melbourne Cup, you become more or less famous, because the horse's life changes, yours changes, the trainer's changes, the owner's changes. And when I was in Sydney last year giving a talk on the Melbourne Cup, even the breeder, he said, my life changed. So the minute you hit the line in the Melbourne Cup, there's five changes in lifestyles, and it never stops.
It's a great story. Unfortunately, we're out of time. Would you thank the rest of the panel? All right. That was a mistake to put the first question to you, John, but a great story. A great story. Rachael, how do you follow that?
I don't know.
Good luck. Yeah. Let's go from the race that stops the nation to the greatest sporting show on earth, and that's the Olympics. Tell us about that in your sport and your first Olympics, walking out there and then competing and getting 2 silver medals.
Well, I had to wait till I was 28 to compete in the Olympics, Koshy, because we didn't qualify for Barcelona in 92, so we're pretty shattered from that. So getting to Atlanta was extremely special, and walking into, and Stewie was there in Atlanta, walking into the opening ceremony is something you never get. Atlanta did it really well because we had to walk up a ramp and then down, so you had an amazing view. And yeah, it's just, I guess Sydney though was the pinnacle because it's a home Olympics, so we were very spoilt to be part of that, because I guess it's only once in every 50 years you might get a home Olympics. Unless how much money you have, I suppose, you get a bit more often. But I think you could just, I'm sure there's a few of you who did go to the Sydney Olympics in this room, and it was just a great party atmosphere. Everyone was in such an amazing mood. You know, we were, I guess, our best opportunity to win a gold that we'd ever had. We hadn't beaten USA, that was our nemesis, and unfortunately we fell at the line and ended up winning silver. So I'm pretty damn sick of hearing the star of the Spangled Banner. That anthem I've had to hear so many times. You know, I played in the WNBA and I've had that anthem ringing in my ear a lot. But I guess the greatest thing in Sydney, we played in the Superdome and it had 20,000 people in the arena. And after the USA anthem had finished, the whole stadium sang Advance Australia Fair. So that's, the sort of stuff that gives you goosebumps and things that you don't ever forget, and just having your teammates alongside you. Athens was pretty amazing because it's where the Olympics began, And even though they did have trouble finishing, I guess, a few things, and it wasn't as spectacular as Sydney, it was quite magical for me because I knew I was going to retire. And I was also a mum in Athens, so my daughter was 2 years old, so it changed quite a lot, I guess, in my how I prioritised things. And but again, we fell at the line and won silver. So.
But you've been part of an era where women's basketball, I'm a basketball nut, as you know, women's basketball has really transitioned into the big time. The WNBA in the United States, television ratings for Olympics have been sensational. It's really, it's a female sport that has just been on a massive growth curve, hasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, we've medaled in every game since Atlanta. And, we talk about the WNBA. I was actually in America last month in Phoenix. And, you know, they average about 10,000 to 15,000 throughout the league, which is what more than the Adelaide Arena holds here for the 36ers. And I guess it's funny because when a lot of people know that you've played in the WNBA, they just assume that you're very rich. But I guess with women's sport, just to give you an example, when Lauren Jackson was drafted number one in the WNBA, she got $120,000. And when Andrew Bogut, Australian, was drafted number one about 6 years ago, he got $6 million. So that's just the disparity that is out there. But I look at, well, I'm in a female sport where you do get remuneration from playing and doing the sport you love. But I've been through the whole, I guess, era that when you first started playing, like curls, it was purely for the love of it. You had to fundraise yourself to be involved. And I guess, you know, I'm sure that you probably covered, Koshy, the recent Liz Cambage and Opal, who didn't attend a training camp because she was going to a music festival. So for me, that's not what being an Opal is all about. And I think too much it becomes a little bit commercial. And, you know, and she's Liz is still quite young. You know, she's going to play in China next season and earn $800,000, which is amazing money for females. But for me, wearing the green and gold was always the pinnacle.
It's great. And... well said. Well said. I was, because I'm a finance nerd, I've been following Michael Jordan's court case against Safeway in the US, where he's suing them for using his image without his at his permission. And as part of the court case, his lawyers were disclosing his financials for last year. Here's a male basketballer, 52 years of age, retired for a long time, and made $100 million in sponsorship last year. It is extraordinary money, isn't it?
Yeah,
stratosphere. Stewie, Tour de France. Is it a funny... It's like the Olympics. Every Olympics, we become... we become cycling experts, don't we? And every year with the Tour de France, we all know what the peloton is. You know, we have no idea previously. Here's another sport that has really captured the imagination.
Well, I'll try and keep it brief because I think Johnny raced for 3.5 minutes and our race goes for 3.5 weeks. So, I'll try and keep it quite short versioned. No, look, it obviously is quite a big event. You know, we average about 200 kilometres per day for 3 weeks. In that, we do get two rest days. Which aren't really rest days because we still have to go training. You can't let the body shut down. But yeah, it's a pretty big thing, I guess.
It staggers me how grueling it is. Mm. How knackered are you at the end of a day? Particularly
pretty knackered.
Particularly in the mountains. What sort of support do you get?
We get to sit down all day. I guess that's a bit of support.
On the world's most uncomfortable seat.
It's not a lounge chair. It's not this beautiful couch. But no, look. It is obviously a very grueling event. You know, pretty much after the first 3 or 4 days, your fatigue level is already, you know, your muscles are hurting, everything's hurting. After about a week, you're knackered. And then you just basically, it's just a lot of, you know, mind over matter. Obviously, we're all there to do a job. The bigger the team you are, if they're to actually try and win the Tour de France, if you've got someone in your team that can win the Tour, you elevate up to him, you actually... learn to sacrifice yourself. You're a lot more motivated than you're just in a smaller team and you're just trying to get to Paris, because everyone wants to get to Paris.
Yeah.
There's a really big party in Paris at the end, which everyone's trying to get to. But it takes you 3 weeks to get there. So.
Mentally tough is it, day in, day out, to keep focus? And Amir's, I have a bit to do with because she's a mad mad port supporter. I've never met anyone so mentally strong as that woman. She is extraordinary. If she wanted to switch the footy, I'd play her, I reckon, because mentally, I've never met anyone tougher.
Yeah, obviously, it's an extremely mentally tough game. I mean, you're suffering all day long. It's just day on, day out. The first week is normally not too bad. Then you hit the mountains. Every single stage you finish, you are empty. You know, for someone like myself, I wasn't very good at going up the mountains. You know, you might start off the day with a 220-kilometre mountain stage with five mountain passes, which are 20 kilometres long, and you've got to get to the end of it. So it's a mind game. You don't want to let your team down. You all know that you're going to be sitting around a table much like you are today. You don't want to be that guy that's pulled out. You don't want to be that weak link in the chain. And it takes a big team unity to get everyone through.
Because you all have a bloke you've got to help, don't you? The prima donna of the team, and you've got to sort of support them.
Well, the prima donna's paid a lot of money, so you don't mind giving him the responsibility.
Does that give you the shits at times? You know, they wimp out, you've got to sort of push them along.
I've been teammates with a few prima donnas, but at the end of the day, most of them came through the goods, and, you know, they're all paid their millions of euro a year, so whatever makes them tick, mate, they, you know, let them go.
See, he's diplomatic, is he? He should be a politician. Michael. Local hero, represented your state so many times. Tell us about, I know as a kid, we go and watch the state matches and we play the Dirty Vics and we just hate them with a passion. What about on field? Was that the same?
Yeah, very much so. Particularly with the likes of Dermot Brereton, which everyone would know. Dermot had, you know, that beautifully frosted blonde hair that looked like a woman, and
did you tell him that?
And I'm good mates with Dermot, and went to Ireland with Dermot. But you know, state games, particularly with South Australia and West and Victoria during the 80s, was an era where South Australia really had a great deal of success. And Graham Corns was predominantly the coach in that era, and he had a group of South Australian guys that. Not only was the coach, Graham, obviously very committed to the cause, but so was that group, and had the likes of Platten, Motley, Bradley, Kernahan, McIntosh and the like. So the core group and stayed that core group for many years. But the games against Victoria, particularly at Football Park where they'd pack out the stadium, you know, was a special time for us, particularly the local lads that played in the SANFL. And, you know, we'd come... Or Teddy Whitten, as we know, unfortunately passed away with prostate cancer, was one of the main advocates for state footy. And it was just such an honour to represent the state. But those games were very physical and, you know, it was very well documented with Dermot and Martin Leslie had stand-up fights. But there was one particular incident in, I think it was a bicentennial carnival game in South Australia where Greg Williams, who brilliant player, a little bit of a sniper, I reckon, but a very good player.
He was an annoying little bugger.
Absolutely. Well, he's actually picked on Gary McIntosh, which is probably not the best person to pick on. And he's belted McIntosh's front tooth out. And when Macca gets hit at the best of times, he's going to respond. Yeah. And Macca was just... So it was those contests against one-on-one, the Kernahans against their fullbacks or centre backs and the like, which was so intense. And look, we were very fortunate to come out in front on most of those occasions.
Yep. Bring State of Origin back, do you reckon?
You know, I look at the rugby State of Origin, and it is just a tremendous game. Mm. You know, it's supported. It's brilliant. Now, I would bring back State of Origin in a heartbeat. Because I think every player would like to play for them, for their state, and particularly South Australia and Western Australia. Now, I don't know, in AFL, you know, like it's big business and you want to keep your players fit, but it's no different to the rugby.
Yep.
You know, it's big dollars, but these games are sensational, and I just think that they should actually play them every year.
Yeah. Represented South Australia on 15 occasions, but also went to Ireland as well. Tell us about that. Was that an experience for a... young bloke from Adelaide?
Yeah, 1984 was lucky enough to go to Ireland, and John Todd was a coach from Western Australia. It wasn't that well liked, and Teddy Whitten was again on that tour, so he actually melded the group together. And it was absolutely fantastic with Ross Glendinning. You had Dermot again on there, Terry Danaher, Mark Lee.
Macca,
Motley, Platten, Bradley.
How did you and Macca go?
Well, Macca was the, I don't know if you saw it, Macca was the goalie that got in that many fights, but we actually had to bunk with these guys. So you'd rotate every 3 days, and I had Macca for the first 3 days, and we're getting ready for the first test, and they had the big function. It was very similar to this, had the big function at the start of the and we were about 3/4 of the way down the back, and it got quite late. And the MC got up, and it was about 10 o'clock before he got proceedings going, and the MC got up and foolishly asked, can everyone hear him down the back? And McIntosh stood up and said, well, I certainly can, but I'm perfectly happy to swap with anyone who can't. So that started the tour extremely well. And then, of course, Macca didn't mind a bit of a drop of red wine or the like. And so I got to bed early, and Macca came in one night, you know, 2 or 3 in the morning, and, you know, snored all night and kept me up all night. And he knew he'd kept me up all night. And I said, Macca, we've got to play a test in a couple of days. And Macca was very rough and ready. He said, don't worry about it. You know, we'll be right. So I got up in the morning, he said, look, I know I've kept you up. I know you've been awake all night. He said, I'll go down and get some breakfast. So we're standing in the main street of Dublin, and he goes down, comes back up, and he said, you're never going to believe what's happened. I said, yeah, try me. And he said, well, I went to the news agency, and I asked for the morning paper. And the guy said, well, do you want the Dublin Times or the Irish Chronicles? And Macca said, I want the Dublin Times. And the guy said, well, do you want today or yesterday's? And Macca said, well, I want today's. And the guy said, well, if you want today's, you're going to have to come back tomorrow. So it was a very eventful tour.
Yeah, absolutely. Mate, amazing career. We're all here to raise awareness for prostate cancer. You were diagnosed at 53. What's your message?
Yeah, look, I was actually being tested from age 45 every year, digital examination, and I hadn't been tested for 2 years, and I was actually seeing another doctor, and the doctor just said, oh, have you had your prostate checked? And I said, oh, actually not for 2 years. My bloods were all fine, and of course, up on the table in the fetal position, which is not all that attractive, and, you know, they put the digit in. Look, for 10 seconds of being a little bit uncomfortable, and he actually found a lump.
But the blood tests were fine.
Blood tests were
perfect.
See,
this is the thing that confuses a lot of blokes out there, because you read this research saying, oh, research is now so advanced, you don't need to have the, you know, bend over and relax. It comes through in your blood. But that's not the case. Where's the doctor? What table's he on?
Peter Sutherland.
Yeah.
Peter?
Oh, Peter, is that right? Do you still need the digital examination? Is that the key? No, because hands up all those blokes who are a bit confused about this, who have your blood tests and your PS whatever they are, so okay, and you go, oh, no, I don't need to be checked with the...
Well, my message is about to be very confusing. In about a third of the prostate cancers diagnosed, the PSA test is normal, but I'm aware that the new guidelines coming out actually don't recommend a rectal examination. So where that leads you, I'm not sure. So I would say to anyone, any man in this room, if they want the full story, they should have a blood test and a finger on their prostate.
And as Michael said, it's 10 seconds of your life every year.
Well, stuff comes out it every day, and a finger going up, it shouldn't be a problem.
Johnny, you were diagnosed at 70, were you?
Yeah. I actually...
I'm glad you've cleared that up, because that's been worrying me. We're getting mixed messages.
Yeah, I was... My blood was pretty right, David. And My doctor suggested that I went into STU on South Terrace, where Peter resides, and Andrew Fuller, and there's also John Bolt's there, Richard Wells, Darren Foreman, and Raj Singh. Right. And I went in there to Andrew Fuller. Yes, I went in. I was recommended to go and see Andrew. I didn't know Andrew. And I can honestly say, David, from the first day that I met Andrew, and he said, look, I'm going to do a biopsy test on you.
Right.
So I had the biopsy test, and he said, I'll let you know the results of it. My reading was 3 on the Gleason score.
What's that?
Which I didn't know what it was.
Okay.
And then it went, he did another biopsy, and it had gone to 6, and I was diagnosed in April.
Right.
Now, I was doing the Melbourne Cup interviews for Channel 7 in November, and I said, Andrew, I would love to do the Melbourne Cup interviews, but I don't want anyone to know at Channel 7 or anything.
Right.
Andrew said, you do the Melbourne Cup and you be here when you unpack your bags the day after,
right,
and we will operate. But the hardest part for me was, David, and look, it's not an embarrassment. Andrew and I are now, I could say, very good friends. We were always, from that day, that moment on.
Not as a result of him examining you.
No, but that moment on.
It doesn't need to be romantic. It's a medical check.
No, but I had an appointment with Andrew this week. He said, your blood's 100%. You're very, very clear. I went under the robotic machine. He gave me the options. He said, your blood's 100%, but he said, come in and have a coffee. So that's the relationship now. He's been with me every step of the way. 18 months ago, I got the Melbourne Cup done. I'd gone from 3 to 6 to 7.
Right.
10 was, you're in a bit of trouble. He told me that.
Yeah.
He took me straight in, and there's this big machine. We did a show for Today Tonight with 7.
Yeah.
And I seen this big machine, and I said, how good is it? He said, put a grape over there. He said, and I'll peel it. He sits over here. You're over there under the machine. And he took the complete prostate out. And I'm completely clear.
That's
of
fantastic.
Prostate.
So, isn't that great? Great story of how a medical examination can then go to a bromance as well. Knuckles, you always tell it straight. Love your view. I'd actually love a bit of mongrel like you in our team at the moment. But tell us what you think. We wouldn't expect anything less. What do you think of this generation of AFL clubs? How different are they today?
Oh, well, talking cheese.
Yep.
Like in our day, there was no money. We were lucky to train 2 nights a week with old fat footballs and no lights. The training session would last about an hour. Then we might be lucky to have another one on Thursday night. So we weren't the fittest like they are today. Gee, they're pure athletes. And that's the trouble. They're athletes, not footballers. And I would say every club in their list of 42 would have about 12 who's not good enough for AFL football. But they've got to have them to fill the numbers for injuries and that like.
Yep.
Watching football today, it's shit house.
Really?
It really is. You get the odd good game.
Why?
Because of the rugby scrums. You know, you got bloody coaches who today coach defensive football.
All right,
attacking football.
I'll take you on here and say you've never seen more games on TV than you have today. And I would say 20 years ago, there were just as many shitty games being played, but you never saw them. Now you see every minute, every second up close. And a great game like Crows v Richmond last weekend was
good
a
one.
Sensational
good
game.
Good
Port v Hawthorn.
Good one.
First half there. A lot of games like that every weekend.
There are good games.
Crappy ones are crappy, but crappy games have always been crappy.
Well, when we played in winter, the oval was like a quagmire.
Yep.
You have cricket pitches there, mud that bloody thick. Peter Phipps one day took off from centre half back. He started bouncing the ball and touching. He kept running, and the fucking ball was stuck in the mud back here. And he forgot about it, but. I cannot work out today why coaches put 80% on defensive football. Okay, so what happens? Port kick 8 goal and the opposition kick 7. Port win. What's wrong with going attacking football, you kick 20, and well, they kick 18.
That's what we try and do. We try to. Love your thoughts on this plan to introduce four umpires.
Oh, Jesus.
Four field umpires to the game. Now, you'd have to love that, wouldn't you?
Some of the umpires wouldn't know shit from clay. They really wouldn't. They're bloody hopeless. Like the poor devils today with the interpretation changes every week. How'd you like to be an umpire trying to work out what do I do this week? Do I penalise that? What about the players? Can I do this? Can I do that? Cooney the other day, beautiful, perfect hip and shoulder, one match suspension. Too rough. What a lot of bullshit. It really is. I saw a game the other night. I watched on that Tuesday, whatever they call it, about 12 years ago. Fantastic game of footy. It really was. It was high marking, one-on-ones. The only time you see a one-on-one now is with all these piddling little short kicks. Yep. Now, they have 20 or 30 possessions. 8 or 10 of them are from a 20-metre pass from their teammate.
Yep.
That's not contested footy. That's bloody girl guide stuff.
some people get annoyed with the number of umpires, particularly an umpire that calls a free who's not closest to the actual play but calls it from 50 metres.
He's got better eyesight, see?
Right.
He's got better eyesight.
Right.
Okay. Because half of them are blind. So, yeah. But sometimes the umpire can be obscured with the back of another player. So you can forgive that situation. But some of the 50-metre penalties today, like you take a mark, I just breathe close to you, 50-metre penalty.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Bring back the toughness. Your message for today on PCA?
My brother had prostate about 12 years ago. Just got it in time, fortunately. Had it done fine today. Whereas my sparring partner, best mate in Victoria, EJ Witten, thought he was bulletproof.
Yep.
Nothing can hurt me. I'm all right. He left it too long, and it killed him. And I went to his place 7 days before he died in Melbourne. And he was blind. I walked into the room, and his dear wife, Val, said, when he said, "Who is it?" And she said, "It's Curls." "Where is he? Don't understand where he is. Stay where you are." So he's got out of his chair, and he's on a stick, and he's come across. I reckon blind people must have sixth sense on where to go. Anyway, he's found me. Well, he's grabbed me by the bloody throat.
He's belted, hasn't he?
And he put out his handshake, as you know, tries to put you down. "Don't come that shit," I said. "You can't put me down anymore." And he died. How he and I became great friends, I'll never know, because we belted one another in state games, and we had so much respect for one another.
Yeah,
I think that's what it was.
And Rachael, your granddad died of prostate cancer. I think a message, you know, because we are bullheads, as Knuckle said, we all think we're bulletproof. Mm. And often takes females in the family just to batter your dad or your brothers or whatever to keep it to the front of their mind.
Absolutely. And because of this lunch and talking to my family about it, I rang Dad to ask Dad, he's 71 now, because of Granddad, I assumed that he'd had a prostate test. And I was mortified when he said, "No, I haven't." So I told him off and I said, "Dad, you have to promise me." Kieran, my brother, he's nearly 50. He hasn't had a test as yet, but I also rang him and told him he has to as well. And, of course, I have a son, Murray, my husband. And I also found out from Mum that her brother has just had prostate cancer and thankfully got it early. So we've actually got it on both sides. So that's made me even, think even more, especially for my son and my brother and dad, that we've got even higher risk of them getting it.
Yeah, and survival rates are just so good now. Mm. And, Stewie, that's the message, isn't it, that... You know, that statistic, more men die from PCA than women do from breast cancer, is an extraordinary stat.
Yeah, it is, and I haven't been affected personally from it, but seeing how much it does affect males in Australia, and we all do have that big macho bulletproof thing about us. I've spent enough time sitting on a bike seat that I'm sure I'll have a problem in the future. but
you're used to the examination, aren't you?
No, I sat on it.
Okay. Ladies and gents, it's just been terrific to have a panel of this calibre and diversity. I'm sure you'll agree. What do you think? Johnny, Rachael, Stewie, I always said Jade, Michael, and Curls as well. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, David.
What a fantastic ride. What a
He's the horseman the whole country knows.
My first one was when I won the Melbourne Cup on Piping Lane. I went over the line and I didn't realise because I'd never ridden at Flemington before. And it was my first ride at Flemington.
Among the newcomers enjoying their first Melbourne Cup in 1972 was Adelaide jockey John Letts. He'd never been to Flemington. He hadn't seen the horse he was booked to ride in the Cup, hadn't met its owner, Ray Trinder, or its trainer, George Hanlon. So when he climbed aboard the Tasmanian horse Piping Lane, he sought some much-needed local knowledge from rival jockey, Harry White.
And I went up to Harry and I said to Harry, I said, how do you ride Flemington, Harry? I said, I've never been here. He said, oh, put him to sleep early. He said, when you get to Chiquita Lodge, make your run from there. And I said, thanks, and I walked away and I thought, what the bloody hell is Chiquita Lodge? And I thought, it must be a 30-storey high motel on the outside of the track, you know, and I won't miss that.
And then guns in, pushing through and battleground the rails. Man your feet.
Unable to spot Chiquita Lodge, Letsy decided to follow the champion grey, Gunsin. Piping Lane scored an upset victory, with Gunsin the gallant third.
Outside is Gunsin, stormy seas, but Piping Lane's going to win the cup.
Eventually, Letsy located Chiquita Lodge. It's a racing stable at the back of the course.
It had control of me and now I'm going to get control of it.
But at last year's Melbourne Cup, Letsy was wondering if it might be his last.
It was in there, this disease, and emotionally it was pretty hard, very, very hard. There were times when I, you know, would cry for no reason at all. You get depressed, you start thinking all the worst things. When you've got a lot of people around you supporting you, John, it makes a difference.
This time, his opponent was within. Letsy had prostate cancer.
It was sort of like a horse race, John. It was a race to beat it, and the other one was a horse race. This was a race to beat a disease.
Now, into his rehabilitation phase, John Letts is an advocate for more technology.
He got every bit out. He didn't touch any of the other organs. It was a five-hour operation. He got a clean sweep of the prostate. It's completely gone. When I came out, he said, there's nothing in your body now. He said, I've got everything. Pick up the pen and paper now and write it down. Doctors this week must do. Because if I hadn't done it, well, who knows? I might have been on medication for the next few years of my life, which wouldn't have been pleasant. And also, well, I mightn't have even made it